you're aware.
And Christine, you're in South Dakota. Is that where you are?
That's right. Yes, I am. Yep.
And how are things in your part of the world?
Depends on which thing, you know. But my household is staying it's up, it's happening, and my work is happening, and we're staying safe, and so that's good. We had a bunch of snow last night, but I see it's already melting, so that's lucky. Oh, wow. For March.
Yeah,
sometimes we don't get March snow still sticks around for a while, but yeah. So my husband has meetings upstairs and my kids are downstairs, and so I've not Zoomed from this space before, but it's working so far, so
good. Yeah, my husband is on a Zoom meeting in our kitchen, and I have a dog at my feet, and I have one kid in her bedroom during a hybrid school, and one is physically at school, so it's, you know, we're all over the place right now.
That's right. So that's about what it is here. Where are you at again?
Oh, I'm in Salem, Oregon.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah. So we don't have snow, but a couple weeks ago we had an ice storm that was pretty dramatic. It coated all the power lines. Some people were out of power for like 11 days. So it was pretty, pretty intense for some people. We were only out of power for 3 days. So it still felt quaint and, you know, enjoyable to light candles in the evening and read by firelight, but I would assume after 3 days it would get really old.
We had one of those ice storms in Des Moines when I was in high school, and I had my hair, I was studying by candlelight because that's the nerd I am, and I caught my hair, I had a strand, like a section of my hair. I just had this like little tuft growing out, like a little, yeah, it was really embarrassing.
That's hilarious.
What we do, you know, to get that AP history class studied for.
Hi, Ada. So I can't see anybody, but I just saw in the chat that Ada said hi.
Yeah. Is that one of your students?
No, that's one of my writing friends. I'm a member of a poetry group here called the Peregrine Writers, and we all get together via Zoom right now and share our work. So lot of the, yeah, it's nice to have a community of writers. Yeah.
That's so great. Okay, so it's 1 o'clock, but we might want to do just like one more minute. Well, maybe we'll just start now because we'll have some people trickling in. And the first couple of minutes, it will just be me talking about what they'll be doing this hour and getting some introductions underway. So I just want to thank everybody for coming. And this is our fourth week of the reading series. And for the Celebration of Literary Arts, sponsored by Des Moines Area Community College. And I think as I've mentioned previous weeks, we usually just we meet at the beginning of April. We have like a 3-day festival, but because of the pandemic, we have a weekly reading series, which opens up the semester for us. And I'm enjoying meeting writers every week. And we have our kind of a loyal band of followers who are here every week. And I'm glad to see some familiar faces in the attendance. So for those of you who are new though, we should mention what we'll be doing today is that we have two wonderful poets visiting us and who will read from their work and have a conversation. But we'll start off with some introductions and a little conversation, and then we'll have them read for about 15 minutes a piece, and then we'll have audience Q&A. So that's where the audience, you guys, anytime during the reading wants to come in and drop something in the Q&A drop box, which you will see at the bottom of your screen. Just go ahead and do that so we can kind of accumulate those questions throughout the hour. And then in the last 15 minutes or so, we can answer them, and we'll try to get to as many as we can. So ask anything you would like there, but we also, as you can see, and people have already engaged with it. We have an active chat that I encourage you all to use. Unlike face-to-face readings where you don't get to just say anything you want anytime you want, you do with the chat. So we've had some funny comments. We've had some great engagement, people calling out lines they like, asking questions, commenting on certain things about poems. So don't hesitate to chime in anytime you want and kind of engage with the reading, even though it's virtual. But we'll start off with some introductions first. So today we have Christine Stewart Nuñez, who is South Dakota's poet laureate and is the author of 7 books of poetry, most recently Untrussed and Bluewords Greening, which is the winner of the 2018 Whirling Prize. She's written several award-winning essays, co-edited 2 books that feature both literary and scholarly contributions. In 2019, the South Dakota Council of Teachers of English named her Author of the Year. As a professor at South Dakota State University, Christine's teaching, creative work, and service has earned several awards, including the Dr. April Brooks Woman of Distinction Award, the Outstanding Experiential Learning Educator, and the F.O. Butler Award. She served on the board of directors for the South Dakota State Poetry Society from 2012 to 2018 and edited its poetry magazine. She's the founder of Women's Poets Collectives, a regional group focused on advancing the writing through peer critique and support. We also have joining us Stephanie Lenox, who is the co-author of Short Form Creative Writing, A Writer's Guide and Anthology with H.K. Hummel. Her most recent poetry collection, The Business, was selected as the winner of the 2015 Colorado Prize in Poetry. She's the author of another poetry collection entitled Congress of Strange People and a chapbook entitled The Heart That Lies Outside the Body. She lives with her family in Salem, Oregon, and works as an editor at Chemikita Press. I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that right. Chemikita?
Chemikita.
Chemikita. Oh.
Yeah. Part of Chemikita Community College here in Salem.
Oh, excellent. Very cool. Well, I was wanted to start off the conversation maybe thinking about your most recent projects and kind of talking to us a little bit about, you know, what you consider your voice is or what your preoccupations are as writers. And of course, they've probably changed over the years, but maybe we can start off with Christine. And I was curious about if you could talk to us a little bit about one of your more recent collections called Bluewords Greening. And maybe you can even start with the title and where that term comes from and how it applies to the book.
Sure. So the title Bluewords, there's kind of like 2 books within a book, and Bluewords is the title for the first part of the book, and it's a made up word, so a nonce word that I made up. My older son Holden has a rare form of epilepsy called Landau-Kleffner syndrome, and so I write a lot about the body and what we don't know about the body and the mysteries of the body, because that's certainly a very big mystery to us. Nobody knows why he got it or how he got it or anything like that. So I have some white lies in the book that I claim that I know where it started, but in reality, I didn't. So the Bluewords is a word I made up to be spoken by anybody with aphasia. So the epilepsy caused him to lose his ability to understand and express himself verbally. And so I was playing with Stephen's 13 ways of looking for or looking 13 ways of looking at a blackbird, and I was like, what's the blackbird? And I was like, oh, it's the blue word, like that's my version of that. So the the first half of the book really explores epilepsy and what it means for a poet's son to lose language, or what it meant to me, or what it was meaning to me at the time. And then the second part of the book takes up, so the greening part is based on my experience with recurrent miscarriage. So I had 4 miscarriages between my 2 sons, and I was really interested in talking about that mystery of the body, not understanding how my body was didn't seem to be working right or working as it was supposed to. And so the greening comes from Hildegard of Bingen. She's a 12th century nun and Catholic saint. And she had this concept called viriditas, which is greening. And it's the sap of the soul is a greening element. And so her work definitely, or her influence, you can see that in the first and the second part. But the greening just kind of speaks to that idea of change, of becoming green, where that soul is, that sap is of the body. And then at the end of that book is a poem based on my second son, because I ended up being surprised by that pregnancy and also surprised that I carried him to term. But at the time I wrote the poem, I wasn't sure and so if that would happen. And so that poem kind of speaks to that end, that actual greening at the end. So that's kind of the way I put those titles together. I'm a horrible, can I admit this? That I'm not a very good title person. And my books always change titles like many, many times before the end. And almost every single time an editor who selects the book for publication will suggest that I change it. And I think this was the thing with this one. I had another title and the editor's like, yeah, what do you think of the title? And I was like, okay, I'll change it. So that's the sections of the book had their individual titles, but then I put that as the title of the whole book.
What was the previous title that you were kind of debating? Or do you remember?
For this one, actually, and this is gonna sound ironic, but I don't actually know was the title. Because that's something my son would say all the time. I don't actually know. And so that was gonna, and then I said, that's all kind of bad.
That might confuse people.
Right. Well, blue words greening, like a nonce word and like a gerund or whatever that is, a party. I mean, I don't even know. Like that's confusing enough, but yeah, it's better. It's better than
it was. Awesome. And so you have been, I just want to kind of bounce off this idea and then I want to move to Stephanie is thinking about, you know, you write some very, very personal poems and very private poems, actually, I'd probably say. And I'm wondering how we had this conversation last week with our visiting writers about how do you negotiate putting yourself out there, getting the private stuff out there. Well, you know, was there any kind of like questions you have or thinking about your son or thinking about what you wanted to reveal or anything? Part of their power comes from their vulnerability that you're putting out to us. But there's also, I imagine, a lot of fear in doing that.
So I can answer that question in for two different ways. So for me, I don't write about anything that I consider private for me. So if it's like, if I'm writing about miscarriage or something like that, like that's personal, of course, but it's not private or else I wouldn't share it. But I also am willing to do that because for me, because I've had, when I was writing these poems, I never intended to share them, for the miscarriage poems especially. But I read them a few times to a few people, and I had enough women approach me saying, oh my gosh, like you writing about something that I've experienced, but I've never put it into words, like, thank you for giving it words. And so I was like, well, it's pretty selfish of me to not try to put these into the world, because if they're helping a few people, like two people, it's worth it, you know, because it's a very unarticulated experience for women. A lot of times people don't know what to say to me, or after they learned about it, people would stumble. And it just, that became very aware that it's not something that people talk about a lot. So I wanted to try. Now for Holden's privacy, that's like a different answer to that. And that's something I've definitely struggled over more, because that's not me. He's not me. But ultimately, there's no way Holden nor I could keep his epilepsy private. When you have seizures in public or meltdowns in public or tantrums in public, or you can't use language, that's something you can keep private. In fact, if we tried, he wouldn't get to go to school. He wouldn't get out in public. Like, and people wouldn't know how to perhaps engage with him or keep him safe if I'm not there. And so it's like part of making a better world for him is trying to narrate some of those experiences and trying to make a space for him and neurodivergent people like him in the world. So it's something I've thought a lot about. It's something I'm always thinking a lot about. I hope that someday, if he's angry that with me, he'll be able to be angry with me, and then he'll get angry with me and articulate that anger. That would be wonderful. If we got there, actually, I'd be fine with that.
So use it as motivation for.
No, I don't think he will be, but I mean, right.
I think that's great, actually, because last week Tracy Brimhall was one of our poets, and she said, as long as the people I know that I'm writing about are, if I'm doing it out of love and they know I love them, then it's okay. And I think that's how you're kind of approaching it too, as a kind of a form of acceptance and an avenue to talk about these things, which is great. Mm-hmm. Stephanie, you write personal poems too, of course. How can you avoid being personal in poems? But you kind of have a different approach to it, and at least in your two previous collections, thinking you kind of tend to find like an organizing principle or some sort of framework outside of yourself in order to kind of move into yourself. Can you talk a little bit about maybe either your collection, your first collection, which is The Congress of Strange People, or The Business that was published a few years ago?
Sure, Mark, thanks. And Christine, I loved hearing what you had to say about the mysteries of the body. I feel like a lot of poems originate from the body and are a way to give voice to some of those mysteries that we wrestle with. So maybe starting with Congress of Strange People. So Congress of Strange People, just to talk a little bit about the title, it comes from the name of a sideshow, Ringling Brothers Sideshow Circus. And when I started writing the poems in this book, I actually started with my fascination of characters in the Guinness Book of World Records, people who were doing really outrageous things, like growing their fingernails as long as humanly possible, or like making sandwiches with their feet. And I was just like fascinated, why do people want to do these things? And the more I went through those pages and started investigating these characters, these people, I began to feel like there is a resonance or a kinship with them. Like I started to understand them beyond just the little entries that they had in the book. And so how I approached the personal poems was to try to embody the voices of these characters. So as I was, I guess I describe it as like I'm a little bit like those guys out in the park with a metal detector who are swinging their curiosity machine over the ground, just looking for something that's buzzing and suggesting that there's something subterranean that's worth digging up. That's how I felt with the Guinness Book. Like there would be one person there that would just buzz for me. And so I would sit with them and think about them. And then all of a sudden I would start to hear their voice in my head. And that's when I'd run to the page and start trying to get down what it was that they wanted to say beyond the story that was in the Guinness Book. And so in some ways they are sneaky self-portraits, but also, they're persona poems, and then I'm wearing a little bit of a mask as a way to explore the connection between myself and other people.
Yeah, as we've been talking about in my own poetry class, we've been writing persona poems and trying to like juggle how do we get the fictional idea as well as empathy, which is really what you seem to be focusing on as well. And then how do you bring, it's not just about them though, like how do you bring yourself out through that mask? And I love that idea of kind of digging the subterranean as a self-portrait, you know, is really what they are.
Right, right. Cool. And you know, I wanted to sort of echo Tracy Brimhall's statement about love. And I feel like as long as the poems are spoken with love and in an attempt to express love or to show the connection, the human connection between people, that there's something positive and constructive that will come out of that. The last thing I wanted to do in my book was to make the characters into yet another freak show where I'm standing back and just looking at them as an object. I, if anything, sort of wanted to trade places with them and be the object of observation and allow people, allow myself to sort of understand what it means to be looked at in that way, sort of explore the strangeness of the familiar and the familiar of the strange.
Right. I love that defamiliarization idea. And I think, and so did you do the same thing in the business, which is maybe office, a cubicle life, which is also kind of a dehumanizing element. And you're kind of humanizing them while also poking fun, like a little satire is involved here, I'm assuming.
Yes. Yeah. Well, and the business is a little bit different. It's, I sort of backed into that book in the reverse. I entered through the absolute familiar. I started writing those poems when I was a secretary and I was sitting in a tiny office and I would sneak little reams of paper home in my bag and in the evenings write poems about what was around me. And it was a way of just processing my experience. I had been reading poetry and I felt like there were lots of poems about haystacks and people staring out the window, but nothing that really commented on my life in an office and dealing with people and office politics. So I wanted to fill that gap with those poems and address it. And when it came to the business, the structure of that, I started to think about how our lives are sort of structured like a tragedy. And so that is the overall structure of the book that I've placed, sort of superimposed the structure of a Greek tragedy on these silly poems that get at the, you know, the popcorn and the dirty coffee mugs in the sink and all the stuff that irritates people on a daily basis, to try to give it a little bit more weight and to encourage people to laugh at the silliness.
Yeah, it feels like you take something that's seemingly mundane and small and you raise it to the level of like Greek mythology. And then Christine, you kind of have like another element where you kind of take like very big topics and you kind of, you know, bring it down to something very intimate and personal and quiet. And maybe this, we can start thinking about reading some of these poems. And so Christine, would you like to start us off with some of your work from any new projects or from past collections? No.
Yeah, I'll read from Bluewords Greening, since that's kind of the focus. So sure. Yeah, there's a poem in here that I like to read because I think it's kind of fun for me to read out loud, even though it's also a bit difficult to read out loud. It's called Lessons in Context. So with aphasia, I couldn't, my son couldn't speak a lot of words. And so no didn't always mean no. And so here's my exploration of what I think no means. Lessons in context. No means maybe. No means you're annoying me with sounds. Can't you see this game right here? Your questions hurt my ears. No means yes if you ask again in 5 minutes. No means I see your moving lips. So? No means no, sometimes. No means I hate that t-shirt. I'm sick of swallowing chalk. That kid over there smells like pee. No means I'm thinking. Persuade me with marshmallows. No means sometimes I enjoy pissing you off. No, no means you're clueless. You don't know what this is like. Here, I'll throw myself on the ground, screaming and weeping to give you a little taste. So that's, you know, one of the things that I've learned as my son has gotten language back is that no is always still his first reaction. Like it's always no or refusal. It's always the first, it's just the go-to. even if he's like, I can't read this word. And then he starts to read the sentence, you know, he just, it's always that thing. And it, and that goes way, way back to the early days of his disorder. So it's intriguing. I think you need to write a new version of that poem and wonder a little bit about that more. Did you want to go back and forth between us, or did you want us to read a couple of them?
You can go ahead. Yeah, let's just do maybe one at a time. Yeah, feel free to continue.
This is another one based on Holden's epilepsy. It's an ekphrastic piece, so I often use art to kind of balance, like Stephanie was saying, using the Guinness Book of World Records, like I use art to kind of bounce my mind through. And so it's a drawing, but then there's also an epigraph from Carolyn Frosche, which is, while sleeping, the child vanishes from his life. And that really intrigued me. There's something called SUDEP, which is sudden unexpected death in epilepsy. And it's when somebody just dies in their sleep, and it's not known if it's a seizure, it's seizure related, but they think it's because of the epilepsy. It's terrifying. And of course, nobody told me about this like 2 years into the epilepsy, that this was even a possibility. I mean, it's pretty rare, but still happens. So boy at rest. In Girl at Rest, I saw only a hazy silhouette of a child's body, the navy blue frame of her arms, head, and a bit of torso. And I read the artist's choice of ochre and light gray, shades shifting only slightly to convey background and skin with wonder. The colors nearly vanish the child. When I study my son asleep, it's in full dimension. Eyelids threaded with a blue vein, a freckle emerging on the outline of his lip. There's no facial stress, but I don't need to guess. Rest is an illusion, not a feature of a brain besought by seizures. By day, they complicate the spelling of C-A-T, blur the way sounds rolling into each other, infuse meaning. When sound does get through the screen of spells, a word may fail to find its place on his tongue. The seizures also erase memories of lunchtime pizza, gym class tag, the answer to what's your last name? The need to look both ways before crossing the parking lot outside the store. On the monitor, I hear him speak, a midnight phrase thrown from deep sleep. And I wonder what words emerge, despite the seizure's surge, from the visual play of his dreams. What world does he vanish to? It seems impossible to draw in ink or words more than a sleeping child's curves and angles. When I tiptoe into his room to retuck his blanket, I only assume that wherever he's at, he'll come back. Yeah, so one of the things with Holden seizures is that he would have one per minute when he slept. So you couldn't see them on the body. His body, you could only see them on the EEG, which is like one of the reasons he couldn't process short to long-term memory. It was because of the pervasive seizure activity in his brain. So, you know, I always, when I'm reading for this book, realize like, I don't have a lot of fun poems in this book. I always start to get a little bit, oh my gosh, I'm glad I'm going first, because I'm a little bit, no, I think one of the only funny poems I guess have some levity to it is this poem called When My OBGYN Said He Didn't Understand Poetry. So it's about miscarriage, but it's also about how nobody seems to understand miscarriage, and you're just trying to find ways to explain and understand. So you can smile, like you have my permission to smile in this poem. When my OBGYN said he didn't understand poetry, I worried, because my body is a more complex text. When he feels the shape of my uterus, he may not think pear-shaped, yet an apricot in size, hollow butternut squash, light bulb. He may not consider it a bowl for a daughter developing inside with eggs for her daughters, a set like grandma's Tupperware poised to seal away meals, or nested like Russian dolls, copies waiting to be twisted off, revealed. My doctor speaks the body's language, uterus tilted towards spine could mean incarceration, womb snagged on the pelvic bone. Almond-shaped ovaries pocked like plum pits, if swollen with movable lumps, could be dermoid endometrioma or chocolate cysts, or nothing to worry about. He questions structure, unpuzzles chromosomes, scrutinizes tensions between biopsies and blood work, and reads all this alongside testimony and history, because my flesh, like a poem, carries mystery. It produced one child complete, but jettisoned the next four. My doctor's glossing of my uterine purse, whether it will stay, it will fill and stay full or remain empty, eludes his science. But when I build a nest of words, paradox and ambiguity kiss each time, offspring running down the page. So yeah. I knew as soon as he said that he didn't understand poetry that I had a poem there. I just didn't know where it was gonna go. Maybe just like one more poem so we have enough time, so everyone has enough time, somebody has enough time.
That'd be perfect.
And this is another poem from that part of the book, from the Greening book, and the Queen Bee speaks. And I attended a lecture on beekeeping, and you know, like all writers, like I'm such a nerd, I was like taking notes and I'm thinking, yeah, this is going to be a poem someday, I don't know what it's going to be. And then I unearthed the notes and it became a reflection on secondary infertility, or infertility could be either way. The Queen Bee speaks. Tick, 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 zaps my biological clock. I've got 2 years, so stop messing around with this cage and queen candy. Inseminate me already. I see a glint in your eye, a ruby ring in your hand. With 1,200 eggs dropped daily, 20 drones just won't do. I want to spawn my own hot hive of workers, a comb of buzzing bottoms, a legion of wings for bee wrestlers to round up. Every day colonies collapse, but my DNA will spread from Sacramento to Bismarck, Houston to Saratoga Springs. My progeny will pollinate almonds, avocado, quince, coconut, and kiwi fruit. My offspring will defend their rights to ramondas, roses, and rhododendrons. My swarming babies will fly far and fly high, and they'll sting this world to satisfaction.
All right. Thank you so much, Christine. That was awesome. I'm so glad you read that Boy at Rest, and that ekphrastic poem. It's funny, like an hour ago, I just got done teaching my poetry class, and we were studying ekphrastic poetry, and we were kind of just trying to figure out different ways that we can use other people's art as a way to inspire our own art. And I'm kind of curious if you have like a take on how you approach ekphrastic work, or what role do you think it has, and how do you go beyond just like summarizing what the painting looks like? And I don't know.
Well, I could talk for hours on this. I give lots of presentations on ekphrastic poetry, and I've done a lot of reading on it, like on criticism of it. So let me summarize to say, it can be as simple as you describe the poem as part of, or you describe the art as part of the poem, and it remains as part of the poem, and then you kind of develop that. So it's like a conversation with that, you know, like the more traditional kinds of ekphrasis. Or you can just totally riff off of it. You don't even, like, there's ekphrastic poems that I've written that you would never know what piece of art I was responding to unless I told you. And there's everything in between. And if you're using it as a form of inspiration, then it doesn't really matter. If you want to have that conversation with that particular art, and you want your reader to have that conversation with that particular artwork, then you kind of need to bring it in a little bit, to have more presence in the poem. But I don't think there's a wrong way or a right way to do it. I mean, yeah, so that's a 3-hour lecture summary.
Right. Well, yes, these are big These are big questions, but that's like, I love that idea of like looking at it from different angles, and there's not just one kind of frastic or one kind of any form, I suppose, right?
One kind, which is really interesting, which I did in Bluewords Greening in the middle in that interlude section. So there's that weird poem that has like five lines, and then it's the process, you know, and then I anagrammed and took out a letter, and I anagrammed and took out the letter. That's right. Because in printmaking, right, in the process, so it's a poem about the process that tries to mimic the process of printmaking.
Yes, yeah. That's so cool. I love like the form matches like the content of the experience. It's really great. And Stephanie, we'll talk about the different forms that you use in a minute here, but would you like to share some of your work with us?
Yes, I would. I'll start with the Congress of Strange People, and I'll just read one or two from this. And the first one is Inheritance, which is not written in the voice of any Guinness Book holders, record holders, but it involves the Guinness Book and this sort of shows my fascination with it. I'll begin, and I have a little story to share about it afterwards, so I'll read this. Inheritance. Sunday afternoons, grandfather and I studied the Guinness Book. Dog earing our favorites. Mike, the headless chicken that lived 18 months before dying in an Arizona hotel room. The man whose arm was severed and reconnected three separate times. Lazarus, Jesus, and the lame girl combined. Your grandmother is in there. He nudged me. Keep looking. I scanned the medical marvels, extreme bodies for the woman he said could balance a piano on the tip of her tongue. I stared at each smudged photo until every woman began to look like family. Same eyes squinting against amazing burden. Other times we huddled over the family tree, its names branching out on butcher paper, me captivated by the word genealogy, as if it contained the power to grant my three greatest wishes. While he plotted everything, traced us back to Singowa, chief of a tribe of pranksters. He pinched my skin until the blood rose. See, you are red. Then he showed me how to cup my hand over my mouth to make a war cry. Once before leaving, he said he had a present for me and dropped something weightless, invisible in my hand. The world's smallest guitar, he explained. Like the one we read about, size of a human blood cell, completely functional. Now, play me a song. My pulse picked up as I tried to think of what I could do. Leaning over with the tip of his fingernail, he strummed once the center of my palm, told me to press my ear against it. And so this poem was sort of the launching point for my collection, where I start to explore the Guinness Book. And as Christine mentioned earlier, there are a few little white lies in this poem that I didn't even realize were white lies until many, many years later. Like I had so embodied this moment in the poem that I was sure that it was totally autobiographical. And then so last November, my grandfather passed away. He caught COVID and was hospitalized. And so he was one of many people who have died as a result of this. And his obit came out, and I was reading it. And there was a line in the obit that said, Ralph Wilson, my grandfather, held a world record for 10 years as the man who caught the largest skipjack tuna. And it was like an epiphany. Like I knew it, but I had forgotten it. And just to realize, my goodness, that was probably underlying so much of what I was writing in the book. And I didn't realize it until like 15 years later. And it just gave me chills. And I feel like it was like one of the final gifts from my grandfather, just to have that moment of connection with him and realize that his life and his stories and the way he looks at the world and his jokes and his heritage are all part of who I am and what I write about and what I obsess about. So it was an amazing just moment of connection. So going from there, I wanted to read one of the persona poems from this collection, just so you could hear the voice of another person. And since we're coming up on St. Patrick's Day, I thought I would read the one about the man who collected the most number of four-leaf clovers. And so with all of my poems, I begin with an epigraph that comes directly from the book, so you can sort of orient yourself to the person. But then from then on, it's that person's voice. So this is called The Collector, a self-portrait in clover. George J. Kaminsky has single-handedly collected 72,928 four-leaf clovers since 1995. A total of 13,383 were collected from within the 5-acre prison yard during his recreation time at the State Correctional Institution, Somerset, Pennsylvania. And a further 59,545 were collected from the prison yard at the State Prison in Hootsdale, Pennsylvania. So, I mean, for me to think of someone so lucky to find so many four-leaf clovers and yet to do so within the restrictions of a prison yard, that had to be a poem. And so here he is. I didn't know what I was looking for until I found it. Deviant weed defying its trifoliate name, splaying its four green lobes toward the fortuitous sky. When I first bent down to take it, distracted by flowers' scent, by the siren spread of grass singing sweetly to lay my body down, I almost lost it. I know the secret of searching for the square in a sea of triangles, and I'm so good now that it hardly feels like luck anymore. Walking this field, they call out my name. Each leaflet I've been told has meaning. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and when a fourth is found, grace of God. Whoever I am, whatever I've done, I remember only the scale of my life's inescapable past. Beneath this tree, I've looked 13,000 times, and 13,000 times I've wished for a knife to carve into its trunk the initials of a name, my own, first letter curving like a sickle, hook of the middle, and then letter of the last, branched like the tree itself. I return to the places I know they flourish. I take everything. I take them all. I take whatever I can lay my hands on. A man here tells me he can calculate my chances, multiply the acreage of the yard, the ratio of abnormal growth, degree of shade, and hours in my day. But I'm not ready to be told how lucky I still might become. These numbers mean nothing to me. I want only to be surprised again by the prolific strangeness of this earth, to be released each day to find goodness, which, small as it is, grows fourfold. And I'll try to squeak in one from the business. It's such a strange book to read from right now, since most of us are working remotely, or many of us are finding ourselves working remotely. So the office feels less mundane and more sort of mythical at the moment, at least for me. So I'm going to read a poem called Secretaries in Heaven. Secretaries in Heaven. This is their new office. alphabetizing clouds, creating a database of prayers received, prayers answered, shooing cherubs off the Xerox, the green beam churning out one perfect copy after another. They have taught the saints how to multitask. Their pearl drop fingernails take dictation. There is no need for correction fluid since they've arrived. Heaven couldn't be better. The souls over their endless coffee mugs joke about who's really in charge. Death has been delegated to them completely. They're just so efficient. The pink stubs of their number twos descending from the heavens in a swift swipe of erasure. The afterlife requires such meticulousness. It is their business, perpetually sending out memos to the living. They know everything under the sun. Calves bejeweled in a shimmering nylon that never runs, eyelids iridescent. They whisper in their cubicles. They know who's next. Here in this chorus of machines, the tone-deaf copier, the cacophony of the fax, the golden swing lines thump and thud. They wait for us. Their round rumps in roller chairs that skim across the great, desperate spaces. So organized, so detail-oriented, singing, "Hallelujah, this is heaven. Please hold." And let's see, Mark, do I have time to share my screen just for a few of the tiny? Okay. So this being Zoom, we have an opportunity, or I have an opportunity to share something that I would not really have a chance to. Are you seeing it? Yes. Okay. Now I'm trying. Oh, here we go. I'm not sure how many of these I'll have a chance to share, but I have a collection that I've been working on recently called The Quarantinas, and it's a self-invented form that is essentially just a paragraph of 40 words, and exactly 40 words. And the word quarantina comes from the word quarantine, which is from the Italian, and my first quarantina will explain that. But it sounds a little like Sistina, so I thought, well, let's try my own form here. And so here's the first one, origins. And what's nice about having them on the screen is that they're so tiny, they're almost over by the time I start them. So this gives you a chance to actually see them before we move on. So origins. Quarantine first appeared in English in the mid-17th century by way of the Italian, quaranta giorni, a reference to the 40 days of enforced isolation required of ships arriving from plague-ridden countries. Etymology is an early form of contact tracing. So, as I found myself attempting to write in the midst of all the chaos that we've all been experiencing in the past year or so, I found it really hard to think straight. And so I gave myself these small assignments. What can I do with 40 words? It felt doable. It felt like something that I could manage when everything else in my life was in pure chaos. So what I decided to do was to write about moments of the pandemic, but not directly, to think about moments in my past or moments that I'd experienced recently that resonated with that. So here's the next poem is from the summer. I was 19 and I worked at Disneyland selling balloons. And it reminded me of being on Zoom, just like we are right now. Zoom. A summer employee for the now shuttered theme park, I learned to duck into doorways with my fistful of balloons to avoid frightening the horses that carted guests along fake cobblestone. disembodied heads, the trainer explained. The horses just don't understand. And I feel like, just like those horses, this whole Zoom thing, I don't quite get it. Just, it's wonderful to be able to chat with people in South Dakota and in Iowa, but it's also so very strange. And it just reminds me of that tentative moment where I'm holding all those balloons and it's like my entire paycheck hovering above my head, knowing that if I lose my grip, it just will go flying off into the air. So let's see. Also, let me squeeze one more in. Yes. I also found that writing these poems to people that I didn't have the opportunity to see was a nice way to sort of feel connected. So this is for my sister turning 40 in quarantine. Could be worse. Think of Noah adrift in his biblical cruise ship. All that animal dung and end times drama. Think of sailors forced to anchor in Venetian ports to prevent contagion. They too emerged into a changed world, or didn't. So I'll end there so that we have some time for Q&A.
Thank you so much. That was really interesting. I love the new form, and I love how you're using like the quarantine and the elements of it to kind of go to, once again, we're going to go biblical. We're going to take this like small moments and make them really, you know, historic. That's so great. I'm glad you read that Secretaries in Heaven. I can totally identify with that. I'm sure Christine can too. It's like, who do you think's running that thing up there? It's like, it's the administrative assistants that are getting things done. It's not the big man. Okay, I love that. So let's look at some of these questions from the chat. Our first one is kind of speaking to the line a little bit. It says, how do you feel about punctuation in poetry? What I truly mean is poetry that respects the sentence. My students seem to automatically capitalize every line and ignore punctuation. Ted Kuser, whose Poetry Home Repair Manual we use, seems to select poems that respect the architecture of a sentence. And I think that's, you know, you think about the line, we can think about sentence, prose. This is something I talk about with students about too sometimes, where I'm like, this doesn't feel like a line of poetry. It feels a little prosy. And they always ask, what do you mean by that? And I'm like, I have no idea. And so maybe you can help us.
Ted was my professor, and I'm listed in the beginning of that book because I told him if he didn't save those emails and turn them into a book, then he would, after he died, I would. And so then he like did that because I was the class he's writing those chapters were first emails to us in that book. So that's my bias, but I will admit that I agree with Ted in that for me, I mean, it's not that I don't like poetry. I like poetry that doesn't use punctuation, and I allow it in my classes, you know, whatever that means. But I just tell my students that they miss an opportunity to for tension, and when they're using the line as the breaking point, to take a breath or to end. There's tension when you can unfold one sentence across 55 lines, right, or 7 lines, or you can have a fragment and then extend the sentence across the line. So James Longenbach has a great book called The Art of the Line, and he talks a lot about, you know, like the whole difference between a sentence and a line. And so I think both of those books, well, having Ted as professor and then James Longenbach's books have really influenced me to take advantage of what punctuation can give us. You know, it's opportunity. It's not a limitation. It's an opportunity to make meaning and enrich meaning.
Stephanie, what do you think?
Yeah, that's amazing that you had the opportunity to study with Kuser. What was I going to say? Oh, so I'm an editor in my day job, so I have a bias toward punctuation and complete sentences. I mean, I feel like there's some poetry and punctuation that gets left on the table if you're not working with it. I've even written a couple poems like Ode to the Semicolon and Ode to the M dash and Ode to the Hyphen. I love punctuation, and it's like musical notation. And so so that would be my bias. At the same time, I'm a big fan of prose poetry, which abandons the line break entirely. And I love the idea of a poem masquerading as a paragraph. Like, it's pretending to be something it's not, and it's sneaking around hoping no one notices it's poetry, that people let their guard down and actually read it. And I love sort of the masquerade that happens when you're writing in prose, but really, really intend to be writing poetry. And so, like in my quarantinas, it's not formless. I'm working with a sentence or with 40 words, but the compression of those 40 words gives a sense of pressure. It pressurizes the language so that I can't just put anything in there that I want to. I have to be selective. And so that's how I get around not having the line break, that I apply some other pressures when the line break's not there. What was I going to say? Something about line breaks. Oh, that's about it.
Okay. No, that's great. Absolutely. I think I love the idea that it like kind of imitates, I mean, punctuation is necessary, so it imitates the sentence, right? But it's sneaky because the language is so efficient, unlike prose, that it has the poetic feel, that compression, as you said.
Right. And that reminds, I think that's what I was going to say, is when I'm working in a prose form, what I'm thinking about is I'm thinking in terms of polarities. Like, there are these moments of tension or like echo throughout the piece where there's like, I don't know how to explain it. There's an connection with other elements of the poem. It's not exactly rhyme, but more of a harmony with something else, either an image or a word that will repeat in a different, slightly odd way, as in order to give the poem shape without the presence of the line.
Right, absolutely. This is a little off track, I guess, but right, we're going to have Ross Gay here in a couple of weeks. Yes. And I'm reading his like latest collection, and he uses no punctuation ever. And his poems are so interesting because they read like sentences, but you have to like reread it over and over again, because he plays a double entendre constantly because there's no punctuation. Uh-huh. And so, I mean, there's like a defense against punctuation, but I also appreciate this idea of like, you got to pay attention maybe more than anything in poetry, because everything counts. You know, I love those thoughts here. Speaking of rethinking your poems and how punctuation works, our second question was thinking about editing and even publishing, and thinking about how we spend a lot of time workshopping and revising in class, but I'm curious about how much editors from publications have their hands in your poetry. This student says, I'm also in a fiction class where we talk about how much editors will ask writers to redo a lot of stuff. And I guess we're curious about when you're doing prose and you have hundreds of pages, you can make big cuts and giant, remove pages and chapters. But in a poetry, it's a little bit more surgical, maybe. I don't know. How do you guys approach it? Stephanie, you want to start us off, and then we can have Christine.
Yeah. Yeah. I like the image of the scalpel, the surgical incision, that is the nature of a lot of the changes. But honestly, I haven't had a lot of publishers who have really gone into the business of my poems and made changes. And it's because most of the time I have put those poems through multiple tests. I have a group of writers who are reading. And so even though I'm not in school, I've created my own little workshop outside of school where I can read my poems to people and get their feedback. And I make a revision and I take it back. And that's, so I'm recreating that process outside the classroom in order to test my work and make sure it's there. And so by the time I get to a publisher, I want it to be cut a word here, make a little tweak here. I want to have done the major revision already. So that's how I think about it. I've also I've had editors suggest different titles. I've always been open to the suggestions of editors because they're so experienced and they have that outsider's perspective. So I'm open to editors making those suggestions, but I've it's never been sort of recreating or completely revamping a poem at that stage.
Christine, how do you approach revision?
I'm absolutely 100% agreement with what everything Stephanie said. So I'm not even gonna say anything because exactly my writing partner, my writing group, whatever an editor says, yes, because you know what? They know, they're good readers. They're experienced. I trust them.
Right. Awesome. So our last question, I guess, is more kind of personal, and you've actually kind of already addressed it a little bit in your work, Stephanie. It's quarantine has been so isolating for a lot of people. Did you find that this affected the way you write? If so, negatively, positively, maybe thinking about how you've changed your writing process a little bit or held on to it as a form of survival? Mm-hmm. Christine, what do you think?
When the pandemic started, I was in the process of revising a memoir manuscript. And so I would get up at 5 every morning before my family would get up at 7. So I'd have 2 hours, 2 solid hours without interruption, because I just couldn't, the interruptions were really hard to, once you get into such a big project, it's hard. Poetry is much easier for me to dip in and out of. I haven't started a lot of new things. I've been trying to finish a bunch of things. And I find that having a plan and working towards that plan to revise helps, because everything else feels so chaotic and unstructured at times. So, I mean, I don't know. I think that I won't see the effect of the pandemic on my productivity for several years, because I've been finishing up things that I've already had going on. I'm not starting anything new. I've written one poem about the pandemic. I haven't processed it, like the whole pandemic. I have not processed it at all. I've just been moving through it. So it's hard to know at this point, really. I've just kind of gotten my tunnel, gotten my kids, gotten my work, you know, just, yeah.
Awesome. And Stephanie, similar, or do you have a different approach?
Well, my quarantinas, I think, is my way of structuring my day and helping me convert this wordless experience into poetry. And I have found, like, during the pandemic, I have even less time to write, even though I'm not going anywhere and I don't have people to hang out with. I have more that I have to take care of. And so giving myself this small project of, okay, I don't need to write a poem, I just need to get 40 words down on a page, it's really comforting, and it helps me feel like I'm inching forward on my writing. So one of the things that I've started doing this year is I've always been a journaler. I've always written in a journal, but this year I've been very, very consistent about it. Every morning waking up, first thing, I use Julia Cameron's The Artist's Way, I think, which is 3 pages of handwritten text every single morning. And I've done it for 220 days straight, even though I've had surgeries and I've been sick and I've had funerals to attend or via Zoom. And I have found that consistent coming to the page over and over again, in spite of everything, is what keeps me feeling, keeps poetry alive for me and keeps me feeling connected to that, the possibility that something good can come out of all of this.
Well, that's great. Thank you so much for that. And thank you both for spending the hour with us and sharing your work and sharing your thoughts. And I really appreciate it. And I know everybody else does in the audience as well. And thank you for sharing your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. So before we depart, at least before the audience departs, I just wanted to mention that we have our schedule in the chat. Next week, we have a Wednesday reading and Benjamin Percy will be joining us for the hour on St. Patty's Day. So wear your green. and then, yeah, that's all we have for today. I appreciate you being here. Thank you so much, everybody. Have a good rest of the day.
Yeah. Thank you, Mark and Christine. So great to read with you and get to hear your work.
Absolutely. Oh, and some people are departing. Also, I'll email you both about details about the contracts and stuff like that, which Stephanie, I think you still have to send yours.
Yeah.
To me. Okay, I just want to make sure I didn't mess up. Okay, that's all. Awesome. Thank you so much, guys. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Like Stephanie said earlier, like this was so well coordinated and it was so thoughtful the way you put everything together. I can't imagine the immense amount of work you put with this. So thank you very, very much.
Yes, it keeps me busy during quarantine. So
yes, definitely. Well, and I hope maybe some of your students are still around, just like how lucky they are to have someone who's reading and thinking about poetry and bringing it all together. So, hey, you guys are lucky.
Well, I appreciate that. That's awesome. Thank you guys.
Okay. Well, have a wonderful day. It was good to share some space with you.
Absolutely. Thanks guys.
Great. I loved your work, Stephanie.
Yeah, same to you. I can't wait to check it out some more.
Yeah, we'll have to be in touch.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.